Welcome. We're talking Mormons, but we're done. Drill.
Left-handed Mormons.
We're back.
Left-handed Mormons.
Steve Lowery, Tom Hoffarth, John McKelvey, and look who it is, Jeff Pearlman, author of Showtime for Local People and the newly published Football for a Buck, all about the USFL. Everyone in this room, except John, has a personal connection to the USFL and the LA Express. So we're going to be talking about that. It's going to be fantastic.
Hey, who's, this is...
No, sorry.
I thought you were going into
so
this
impatient.
Whole...
You're this is one of my best friends, and this dude is angling to take him from me, so, all right? This is Chris Dufresne. You know the name. You've read him for years in the LA Times. Now Chris is with TMG College Sports. Fantastic website. You should get on. It's like cheap. It's like what, 10 cents?
This is the talking rock for today's show.
Get away
it's
with
the
this.
USFL goal.
But Chris actually covered the LA Express for the LA Times. So,
this is true.
This is true. So we got that. So we have lots of USFL stuff.
And I covered it for
about.
The Daily Breeze, but that's an afterthought.
That's it, yes.
And you guys were PR. You and
myself and Steve Vanderpool. I don't know if we can see Steve over here.
On the
we were actually interns.
Young, you're younger than I am.
I know. I was the same age as Steve.
Yeah.
And so, but he's doing.
But you were on with your career, and I was working as an intern.
I was still in school.
That was the only internship I could get, which tells you something about the LA Express. Before we get started, I just want to say one thing, and this has nothing to do with
remember, this is about Pearlman.
Right, I know.
I'm
right.
Sorry.
But this has nothing to do with Jeff right now.
He's trying to sell books.
I have the ball.
If you're watching
it's
us,
all about selling
one of
books,
the
buddy.
Three people are watching us. What you might not know is in the TV biz that, of course, we are in, the single most important thing about broadcast success, and John will back me up, it's not the cameras, it's not the audio equipment, it's not even the talent. We're the talent. The single most important facet is the chairs. And as you may have noticed, our chairs have been ripped off and apparently taken to some tennis event.
Yeah, we're working a nice tennis event for ESPNU this weekend, and that talent is taking priority over you guys.
This is more comfortable anyway.
Well, what, are these chairs?
Usually we're in these big director's chairs, so I feel like a big man. And so this is bad.
Sorry,
and Jeff is slouching, and I appreciate that because he would tower over me. Hey, Jeff, read your book. It was fantastic. And one of the things following you on Twitter that is apparent is you're very upfront about saying you took much less to write this book.
I did.
You went through many hoops to write this book. People tried to discourage you the whole time. What was the driving passion to tell this story?
I mean, I think I'm like everyone here.
Yeah.
I just love the USFL. I love the weirdness of it. I love the kind of quirky innocence of it.
Yeah.
I love that it challenged the NFL, that it was genuinely fun. And also, I mean, I don't want to make you guys feel older. I was 10 years old when the league came out. And I remember being a kid. I mean, I've said this a lot, but it's really true. I grew up in Mayo Pack, New York. My family would not subscribe to Sports Illustrated because it was too expensive. So we got Sport Magazine.
It's true.
And I would go to the Mayo Pack Library. And I remember seeing Herschel Walker on the cover of an issue in 1983. It said, Hitting Pay Dirt. It was him with a general's helmet. And I feel like younger people don't get. Like, Herschel Walker wasn't just the next Heisman Trophy winner, right? He was he was iconic.
The future of the game.
Yeah, he was kind of Jim Thorpe, Bo Jackson, like that. Different level.
Yeah.
You know, he wasn't just Billy Sims. It was like a lot bigger than that.
Right.
And him going to the Generals. And I remember opening the issue and seeing the 12 helmets floating in like space. That's what it was supposed to look like. And like the LA Express probably had the most boring helmet of the bunch. And the LA Express had a kind of a cool helmet. But the Arizona Wranglers had this awesome helmet. The helmets were insane.
Yeah.
And just when you're 10 years old, everything seems giant.
Yeah,
you know?
Exactly. Was that the Sports Illustrated where Herschel had his girlfriend on his back and he's doing push-ups?
I don't know. It might have been the same issue because that's, and it's really funny because that issue talked about Herschel signing and he said, J. Walter Duncan was the owner of the, like Donald Trump actually likes to say, he has said in the past, I brought Herschel Walker to the USFL. Yeah. He had literally zero to do with it.
He
it was
turned him down. He blew them all off.
He blew them off. Yeah. It was Walter Duncan. And he went down as old, you know, he was probably 70, not that so old, but he went down to Herschel Walker's apartment in Athens, Georgia, sat there with his girlfriend and played Space Invaders on the Atari 2600 and got him to agree to a contract.
Yeah. Today would be Fortnite.
Yeah,
true. Oh, there you go. Yeah.
Herschel was Herschel before Bo Jackson. Now, Bo would come shortly thereafter.
Yeah,
and then Bo would, I thought Herschel was, but same kind of freak, just freak athlete.
Yeah.
Herschel was so fast going forward, he didn't have like a lot of swivel, but he could go, he was bigger and faster through the middle like a train.
Do you think that like back then, college stars like Herschel Walker could become like legendary because we didn't get to see every game? fact that they were mysterious. Because you're right, Herschel Walker was much bigger than any big college star is now.
Yes.
Yeah.
And one of the great games of all time, the 85 opener, the LA Express and Houston Gamblers, Jim Kelly, Steve Young. That wasn't on TV, right?
No, not on TV.
Not on TV.
No, right, right.
And that's when Kelly set the pro record, not the Canadian. I don't think the Canadian.
The pro football record, yeah.
They combined for 945 yards or something.
A passing? Yeah.
So that takes on a whole aura of...
This is the game nobody saw except us.
Right.
You know, we were there.
Was it as good as a...
Oh,
I don't mean to take your job. I mean, was it as good as a... You're not just not doing a good job. Was it as amazing as they say?
Or the paperback version.
Or was it preposterous? Do you know what I mean? Like, was it cool or was it...
I remember the Express was way ahead, like 33 to something, and we might have been... I remember being down on the field for the end of it, because you go down the field at the end of the game. At the call, at Express games, it was very easy. You didn't have... you're at a Rams game, or you have to plot a USC game. I better leave now, because all the fans are going to leave. No, you could go. You could hear, and this is not... You could hear, and Young used to complain about that... You could hear him from the press box, like calling out plays or in the huddle if they were screaming at something. That's how quiet it was. We'd go down to the field, I just remember these. All I remember is from Jim Kelly's arm.
Yeah,
you know, it's just like these little.
And this, of course,
that's the
mouse. That's the mouse Davis. Right. That's the mouse Davis.
Running shoot. Yeah. Richard Johnson, right?
Portland.
It was it's crazy. Richard Johnson.
Yeah.
Ricky Sanders.
Yeah.
Gerard McNeil. Yeah. Clarence Verdan. Stanley Floyd, the All-American sprinter, tried out because he raced a horse on That's Incredible.
That's right.
And the owner was like, let's get that guy in here. Yeah. Vince Corvette, who ran a 4.240, was one of the receivers. It was in, I think it was Richard Johnson told me they had one of the, they could have put a relay together that would have competed on the national stage.
Oh, yeah.
And I actually agree with that.
Yeah.
But we didn't know it was Jim Kelly then.
Right.
No.
Yeah.
We knew it was some
guy from Miami. Yeah.
Miami, who kind of had an injury-plagued career at Miami.
Right.
And Steve Young was certainly, you know, when Steve Young came out, and I didn't cover colleges then. I was covered more NFL, and I didn't really see him play that much at BYU. When they signed him, this was a big deal.
It was.
He comes out to the practice field, and I remember standing, watching him throw passes next to Don Klosterman, the GM, and he's throwing passes, and they're like going, I told Klosterman, this is your $40 quarterback. I go, this guy is one of the greatest athletes you'll ever see. Trust me on this. Don't even.
Yeah. I just covered him in the Holiday Bowl.
He had great numbers at BYU. Yeah. Yeah. You could see. I mean, just.
But it was. You thought he was a college great athlete.
He looked like he could have been. He's one of the few players, quarterbacks that you could say. Could have played running back in the NFL. Mm-hmm.
Sure.
Yeah.
And
actually ended up
doing
that. That was his last game. He played running back for the Express because they ran out of players.
But we didn't know.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that is true.
The funny thing is people were asking me during the book, is it true Steve Young ran for 150 yards in a game as a running back? And I'm like, actually, he ran for 0 yards, but it's good.
But he did have a game of 300
Better
yards.
Better story, it's 150.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, he did have the game of 300 yards passing and 100 rushing, which had never been done before. It was done, I think that was the first time.
Yeah. First time.
Yeah. Now they do it all the time. You can't believe it, but back then it was a big deal. 100,
yeah.
300,
yeah.
100 was unheard of. But
Tommy, you were still in college when you got the assignment, right?
Right.
So were you actually hired at the Breeze, or were you an intern there?
No, I just got hired full time.
And how did they approach you?
The funny
part
was Chris Mortensen was working at our paper and left to go to Atlanta, so there was a job opening. So I got promoted. And while I was in college. And then since I was down there, they said, why don't you just cover the Express? They're kind of in your neighborhood.
Yeah.
So why don't you do that? And so, but the practices being in Manhattan Beach made it hard for me because the way to go down to Pollywog Park. And I remember Steve Young after one practice goes, I go, what was the highlight? I missed the practice. He goes, these kids were out fighting in the park. He goes, they were fighting for the championship at Pollywog Park or something. They were just would love to see the kids. It was at this old elementary school.
Right. I think the Raiders had used
Yeah. No, the Raiders were still in El Segundo. They used like this other one, but now it's a middle school. But so again, just how everything ties together. One of the Bob Rose was the main PR guy for the Express,
the
and
best.
His assistant was Sheila Young.
Yep.
And this guy
violated all journalistic ethics.
That's right.
And well, I
didn't give me any good stories after that.
Well, I actually had to tell my boss. Because we did not start dating till 85 season, last season.
Well, that's when everything was falling apart for everybody. It was like a grab bag. Just take what you can from the Express.
She would literally take stuff out of the Express the team, it was like looting.
Yes. Right?
But I did tell my boss, and I said, I got a problem. I'm dating one of the, but she's going to be fired, laid off.
Right.
She said, don't say fired. I wasn't fired. I was laid off. I go, she's going to be laid off. Right. And then I looked at my watch.
But Vanderpool knows this. This was a whole Jim and Pam situation.
Oh, yeah.
Because
yeah.
their like of each other was well known.
Yes.
And this one would talk to you, and this one would talk to you. And I have to say, I played a key liaison role in this.
And Steve Young was one of the only other people that knew about the relationship.
No relation.
No relation.
Oh, that's right.
And Bob Rose, I think he might have been the third. Yeah. Kept very close.
Yeah.
I just say...
But this is about, what's this about you?
No, I want to say, I just want to say.
I didn't write a book
about
it.
Anyway, open your eyes.
In a very related story.
I think it's in here.
The New York Daily News sent Harvey Arreton to cover the first championship game. And which is great. And we guys had, did you cover the first championship?
Oh, yeah,
in Denver.
There. Yes.
Which is the greatest because the USFL desperately wants a great game because the NFL has had these crap Super Bowls year after year. And you got the Michigan Panthers, you get the Philadelphia Stars. The two teams that you could make an argument could have played in the NFL and gone 7-9, 6-10.
Right.
Bobby Hebert, Anthony Carter, Calvin Bryant, Sam Mills.
Right.
So this game goes on, and it's great. Right? It's a great game. It would go down as a great Super Bowl if that game were a Super Bowl. They'd call it one of the 10 best Super Bowls. And Bobby Hebert hits Anthony Carter. Big Michigan wins. Minute and a half left. The fans storm the field, right? This is the best thing ever.
It's true.
The Denver police are under strict orders. Do not let anyone do anything to the field. So the fans rush the field. The USFL, in such a USFL moment, they allowed Miller to have a free beer promotion before the game in the parking lot. So everyone is sloshed out of their mind by the fourth quarter. Fans are attacking the goalposts. They're tearing them down. The police, you were there.
I was there.
Cops start macing. I'm sorry, they're macing people. And there are dogs. And the dogs are attacking fans. The PR woman for the league is like handing out stuff in the press box. Like, that was a Bobby Hebert MVP. Meanwhile, on the field, like, people are getting attacked. And Harvey Arreton ended up marrying the PR woman.
Oh!
Putting your story of love kind of in page 17B.
Love among the ruins, yeah.
Those are always my favorite phone calls at the office. I need more room. What do you mean? They didn't want to cover this league. They had nothing to do. They're going to put the championship. Well, a riot broke out.
Great.
Jim, how did you get the gig? What were you covering at the time?
This is a great story. I was covering UC Irvine basketball, which I continued to cover. I covered both sports it wasn't like an everyday thing with the Daily Express, but when they announced this league, and I found out from Jeff's book, it was kind of one of these moments that San Diego was supposed to get the franchise. Mm-hmm. Not L.A., and they had problems with Jack Murphy Stadium. And I was reading that, I'm going, whoa, that's like one of those moments where, my life is it's completely different.
Right.
If San Diego gets it,
You're not sitting here right now.
No,
right.
I'm not here. I'm not alive.
I think
I would have just died.
You're right different now. Something, yeah.
Oh, but screwed.
So the bottom line is we were all working in Orange County. And LA wanted nothing to do with this. Dwyer had the Olympics coming up in 84, which would be the crowning achievement of his career. And we should have won the Pulitzer for that, but didn't. That's another story. He wanted nothing to do with this. We already had two football teams, two basketball teams. Give it to some kid in Orange County.
Yeah.
So that's the story. I heard it all these years. So a few weeks ago, I mentioned this in the little thing I wrote up for about Jeff's book. And I said, I think I won on a coin flip. I'd heard that story. I won on a coin flip. And Bill Dwyer, my former sports editor, emails me and says, you're right. The guy you won, you beat out was Rick Riley.
Rick
was in the Orange County edition of at the LA Times. And I picked him up at the airport from when he came from Denver. I won, and then Riley immediately tweeted, I want a reflip. So it's just like I beat out Rick Riley for a job that they didn't want anything to do with. And then it just became so interesting that,
You said they weren't interested in your Steve Young. I mean, when you called them.
I was covering a UC Irvine basketball game, and I was in the SID's office at Irvine filing my story when I got confirmation that the Express was going to sign Steve Young to this huge contract, $40 million. And I called the office, the editor, and I was in Orange County. So L.A. was the big guys and the big editors and the scary guys, and they were always changing your copy and yelling at you.
Yeah.
So I told them, you know, I was 24 years old, and I said, they're going to sign Steve. Oh, how do you know that? You know, it's like the editors saying, yeah. I'm the beat writer. I talked to a really good source. Yeah. Don Klosterman. Yeah. He was the general manager of the Rams.
Yeah.
So, well, how do you know that? Well, you better be right. I said, well, you know what? If you want a story, I'll be happy to, you know, I kind of got pissed off. If you want a story, I'd be happy to write one for my paper. If you don't want it, then, you know.
Do they run it in front of the sports section?
I don't remember what I try to look for that story. I have a bunch of clips that are just all, you know, we have digitally everything from 85 on. I have when I left the Times, I accessed all my files, but everything before that is clips. Mm. And I haven't been able to find that original story. So I don't know if it was a front page story on Sunday, but newspapers in those days, it had to be like a that Mona Lisa had been stolen for them to change the front page.
Sports was never.
Oh, really?
It was too hard. It was
like,
too hard to change.
You know, they changed all that. So I don't know if it was on the front page or not. They finally understood that they couldn't ignore the story.
Right.
And then they had the press conference was big at the Beverly Hilton. Was that,
yeah,
was
I remember
Orson
that
Welles one. That Steve was ordered?
Remember they signed it on a piano bench. They signed his contract.
Jeff, you broke down that contract.
Oh, yeah, that was
and
the
best. And it says that he's supposed to get paid till he's 60 or 65?
Yeah.
Is he still being paid?
No.
What
you,
no,
I think
no.
He ended up getting about eight of 40.
He got a buyout to go $2 million. He ended up with like $4 or $5 million.
He had to buy himself out to go to the NFL.
Yeah, he had to buy himself out. But he ended up getting, and they never funded the annuity, which was, you know, I said, we could have, you know, if you, it's like one of those things that we could have almost made.
Yeah.
If you put a,
right.
You know,
they did him a real disservice because Walter Payton, I wrote a book about Walter Payton, mm-hmm. He signed a very similar contract. And nobody called it a $32 million deal because it wasn't, his contract wasn't a $40 million contract. It was an incremental payout over a gazillion years. But they wanted Oldenburg, who's just a psychotic crazy man, didn't care about the pressure he was putting on his quarterback. They just thought this is great for headlines. And it was, but it killed him. I mean, you know.
He hated it. And there are certain guys that would have played that up.
Deion Sanders would have loved that.
Deion would have loved it.
Lee Steinberg loved talking about it.
Lee's
career.
Steve Young hated it. He wore it on his face. He wouldn't cash his checks. You could detail a lot of that in the book.
Well, I love when the fans in Washington, I mean, he told this in the 30 for 30, or taunting him. $40 million down the drain, and his mom is in the stands. And she's like, "It's an annuity. It's an annuity."
Oh, we're sorry.
Like George, it's Costanza. A poor Mormon woman who's like very polite, and they're like, "Yeah,
you, the Mormons."
Yeah. I love the Mormons. That's what I'm saying.
You mentioned William Oldenburg, who was our boss. So Stevie, if we can get Stevie in on this, so this guy, you call him in the book like a psychopath, He was one of these guys, if you had to do his, like I remember no matter what you wrote, like as a PR thing, like I wrote about a linebacker, you'd have to mention somewhere in there that Oldenburg had signed him, and then there was all this stuff you had to always mention that
IMG,
he owned this.
IMG,
that
IMG, right.
IMG.
That sounds like doesn't that sound like another owner of the league? Just a little
and
bit.
We'll get to him.
You always had to mention all these things, like he owned this, he did this, he was the world's greatest negotiator. And then on game days, he would like have a suite at the Coliseum, and if you were called up there, you were made to feel like the help. Like, come here, get this guy this, do that. And you're like, he was.
Now, were there massive drugs? I mean,
just a lot of celebrities that were well past their primes. I mean,
yes.
Who's the definitive?
Well,
LA Express.
Wells, and then, of course, I think it was the opener. Was it the opener that Wayne Newton performed a post-game concert?
Yeah, we got to see. But we also
Chuck Berry did a concert.
Chuck Berry. I mean, I like a lot of the post, you know, the entertainment.
Yeah.
You know, I don't really have the Pointer Sisters, but he had the business with IMG, and then anytime he did a big business deal up in San Francisco, they had the giant gong.
Oh, the gong, yeah.
They had to bang the gong whenever they did a big business deal.
And he had a marquee, like they have in Times Square, like a neon flashing marquee. So like when Steve Young and Lee Steinberg came to sign the contract, officially sign the contract, they come to the building and Steve Young, world's greatest quarterback. Lee Steinberg, agent extraordinaire. It's like, what? Then he ends up kicking him out in a drunken, you know.
Well, you described that fight. whole contract negotiation where he is, he's hungry, it's his birthday, he wants to go to a party, and he keeps coming in going, well, come on, sign the thing, whatever.
It's like the best.
And he's just out of his mind.
He was zest. I mean, he was crazy, and he was, that night, I mean, the contract was, the terms were agreed upon, and they just went to his office to sort of work out the details, and Oldenburg's upstairs in his suite. And downstairs are his minions, Steve Young and Lee Steinberg. And every hour, hour and a half, he comes down to check on it. And every time he comes down, his cheeks are redder and he's more drunk. And he'd be like, why is this taking so long? Blah, 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 blah. Mr. Oldenburg, it's just blah, blah, blah. All right, I'll be back in an hour. What the hell is going on? Finally, he calls for them to come up. And he's doing this to Steve Young. And Steve Young, the nicest human being on the planet, as far as mild-mannered. And if you poke me one more time, I'm going to pop you. You know, like typical, like Richie Cunningham, Steve Young. And Oldenburg ends up, he's drunk. He has all these glass bottles in a bar. He smashes them all in his fit. He picks up a chair like this. He runs to the window to throw it out of the penthouse window. Steve Young grabs him. And Bill Oldenburg finally kicks him out onto the street. And Steinberg told me 2 a.m, it's Steve Young and Lee Steinberg just trying to figure out how they're going to get home.
There's no way.
They got kicked out. And the next day, Oldenburg apologized. And
wow.
And he's like, and Oldenburg is only the third, one of three owners the Express had. So and they started with a group, two guys, Harmon
and Daniels.
And Daniels, who were cable guys.
Yeah. Who got out with it, who made money. They made money. Who made money off the USFL?
Right. Well,
Steve Young.
Or, did Steve Young? Flutie did. Flutie had 3 years guaranteed. Yeah. Blanding, the gold owner, sold high. And
did Bassett make money?
No, Bassett definitely did not make money.
That's too bad.
Most people
didn't. I liked him.
But Bill Dan, the original ownership was, I mean, Alan Harmon was a sideshow. He was like a clown.
Right. No, yeah.
He was a clown.
Right.
But Bill Daniels was, you know, basically created cable television.
Right.
He was like,
he hooked up with Jerry Bust and made Prime Ticket and all that stuff.
Prime Ticket.
And he was the last guy after Oldenburg disintegrated into a pile of rubbish. But was this guy Jay
Roulier
from Houston who...
You couldn't have worse business judgment than to buy a team in the USFL in 1985.
Oh, like, my God.
I don't actually know what would make anybody, besides an enormous ego...
Unless he thought that they were going to win this lawsuit or something. Or
it was just insane, though. Yeah.
It was... Bill Daniels was a, you know, very astute businessman.
Yeah.
And he saw, even after 1 year, he saw the where this
was... Because, again, as Jeff pointed out in the book, it's ESPN had just launched. They were part of the TV deal. ABC was part of it. And Daniels probably saw some future in it as programming, because that's how they always look at this, as programming. So when he got out, that should have been a sign.
That was a – yeah. And then I think he saw Trump when Trump got in.
Yeah, when Trump got in at that point.
I'll tell you who made money. Duncan, who sold the team to Trump, he sold it for $10.5 million. He was asking $8 million. Trump paid $10.5 million. And he made money on that deal. He bought it for $6 million. He sold it for $10.5 million. That guy got out wisely at the right time.
Yeah.
So what a deal maker.
Yeah. I know, right?
Art of the deal. Art of the crappy deal.
The guy who said buying the Dallas Cowboys at $500 million was a bad deal. And
I mean, you got one of the great reasons why this book is getting a lot of good run right now is because of the Trump connection. Mm-hmm. And it's an easy in for you to talk about. And I don't know if you wanted to sort of summarize the whole Trump part of this as a sort of a way to tie it together. But
it's a really interesting and weird. I've never promoted a book like this where it's like MSNBC, ESPN,
right.
You know, and it's really weird, and it's almost, I don't want to talk about it at all, but it's almost hard to tell if talking about Trump these days is a good thing or a bad thing, because a lot of people, like I was on Rich Eisen's show yesterday, and then you see the tweets, I didn't tune into the Rich Eisen show to hear about Trump, you know, like it's a lot of that,
right?
And I actually understand that. I actually do get that reaction to it. That being said.
No, but that is part of the book.
Yeah, of course.
And it's not why you wrote it.
Yeah.
It was the whole your love book, but it just happened to land at this time.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you can get this all out of the way now so we can go back and talk about the Express, but it's just, it has to be sort of kind of figured out.
So he bought the team. He was supposed to be an original owner. And in 82, a bunch of the owners were meeting in San Francisco in a suite. And he was supposed to be, he was the big guy from New York. And the funny thing is no one knew who he was. Mm. You know, he was not well known outside of New York. And all the owners are waiting. They're waiting. New York guy's coming. Don't worry, he's coming. Phone rings. You can picture it. Like, all of us are having 80s ties, except for you, damn it.
Like, nope.
Yeah, that's all right. Imagine this anyway. Like beige phone in the middle with the big buttons.
Right.
Oh, Donald Trump is calling in, speaker. Hey guys, it's Donald. I got some bad news. I'm not going to be coming. I'm just not going to do it, but I got some big things going on. Sorry, blah, blah, blah. Click. Good luck. People are like, what the hell just happened here? Right. We just lost our New York owner. Fast forward, Walter Duncan, an Oklahoma oil man, truly out of decency, he's interested in the league. He says, I'll take the New York team, right? He had no ties to New York. Was
right.
Actually a decent
right.
act.
Right.
After a year, he's like, I don't really feel like making this flight anymore and all this stuff. Donald Trump comes in, buys a team. In the lead up to buying the team, he loves the USFL. It's a great idea. I love what they're doing. Smart, blah, blah, blah. He gets a team. As soon as he gets a team, we need to move to fall. If God wanted football in the spring, he would have invented baseball. That's his line that he thinks is clever. And, you know, he really starts undercutting the league. And he has a meeting with Pete Rozelle at the NFL commissioner in the Pierre Hotel in New York. And he says to him, I don't give a crap about the USFL. What do I have to do to get in the NFL?
Right.
And Pete Rozelle says to him, as long as I'm involved in this league, as long as my heirs are involved in this league, you will never be a part of the NFL. Because people say, well, why would he say that? Because he saw what he was. Mm-hmm. And I always say, like, it would be unwise to marry someone who cheated on their last spouse. Like, you know, there has to be something. Yeah. And if you're Pete Rozelle and you're sitting there, and this guy's undercutting the league he's literally in right now, I'm sure Donald Trump thought he was very clever and very... Right. But if you're Pete Rozelle...
You're just giving out your game plan.
You're giving out your game plan.
Out of how you're going to screw up the league.
100%.
Why would you go to the NFL if you're going to... He'll undercut that, too.
And also, at the time, if you remember, the NFL was all about old money. You know, it was the Maras and the Rooneys. You know, it was just these old money families. And Trump was not old money. Trump was new, cocky money. Anyway, Trump is undeterred because his one strength, whether you like him or dislike him, the guy does not give up. He just charges ahead. So he starts talking about how we still need to move to fall. We have to move to fall. And Eddie Einhorn, the Chicago franchise is failing the blitz. And Eddie Einhorn, they bring him in as a potential next owner. Never put a dime down. But he's supposed to be this TV whiz. So he and Trump go about, lead the process of seeing if there's a fall TV deal. And they just flat out lie about it all. They meet with different TV executives and the consensus is no. Like, and it makes no sense. Why would you want to broadcast the Spring Football League when you have the NFL already? It doesn't make any sense. But they lied and they said, no, there's a lot of interest. Really, we can get a $90 million TV deal. Owners were unhappy with the ESPN ABC deal because there were no blackouts. Oh, and that was a huge problem.
Right, you pointed that
you
out,
know, a huge problem. You can see it in L.A.
L.A. was a huge problem. Yeah,
right. Not that anyone was watching it on any medium.
You can't fill the Coliseum anyway.
Right. I mean, that was a dumb stadium to play in.
The Rams don't fill the Coliseum.
Right. That's right.
Right, exactly.
They didn't even take that in consideration. You should have been playing in a smaller facility.
Yeah. I mean, if the StubHub Center were around then,
that
would have been a great USFL stadium, you know? And it would have been Orange County is accessible. I think it would have been, anyway.
Yeah, no, you're right.
Right. So,
we should start a spring league and put it in spring.
We'll call it the Express. We'll invite Donald Trump to
ruin it. Great idea.
Pierce College. I am,
I'm haunted by Pierce College. I'm haunted.
That.
I just want to acknowledge quickly. I've only had one mistake pointed out in the book, which actually is pretty good for, I mean, I'm not happy. And I found out, I think you told me, right? Pierce College was, I have his Division III, it was NAIA.
No, it's a...
What was it at the time?
It was a junior college.
And I also had the name of the stadiums off slightly. Right, and I'm haunted by these things. And I was like, how did that happen? And then I looked and I found the clip I had used from 1980, whatever. I'm not even joking. And there was an Arizona Republic clip talking about that last game. And they had it as, and I used that clip as my source.
That happens.
Anyway, I digress. Yeah. So Trump basically put, we can get fall, TV deal, blah, blah. And then he starts talking about, we need to sue the NFL.
Right.
We're going to sue the NFL.
Because that's his MO.
That's his MO. Sue everybody. I mean, there are guys from the USFL I talked to. He hired someone to plan their whatever press conference. It was 1,000 up front, 1,000 after. Trump paid the 1,000 up front. The guy sent him multiple bills, never paid him. You know, just blew him off. It was just what he did. So we're gonna sue the NFL. We're going to hire Roy Cohn as our attorney. McCarthy era, Roy Cohn.
Oh, yeah.
Famously evil and sinister.
Yeah.
They hire Roy Cohn. And Trump tells the other owners, we will hire Roy Cohn. They will settle immediately because they're going to be terrified of Roy Cohn.
Yeah.
That's his whole thing. Well, that did not happen.
Right.
Paul Tagliabue actually was not the commissioner at the time, but he worked in the NFL. And the NFL was nervous about this all. Paul Tagliabue sort of had this meeting with the owners. And he's like, if we give in on this, every time some new league comes along, they're going to pull the exact same crap on us. Mm-hmm. And we're going to be vulnerable forever. We cannot give in on this. So the NFL basically says, bring it, you know? And they file the lawsuit. They don't settle. the USFL was correct. The NFL did, what they were saying is the NFL monopolized fall TV, which they did.
Yes.
The NFL was undercutting the USFL, which they certainly were doing.
Yep.
So that's the whole case. The trial happens in New York. Jerry Argovitz, the owner of the Gamblers, is begging Trump not to have this trial in New York. Have it in Houston. They'll be much more sympathetic to a plaintiff, blah, blah, blah. No, it's my town, blah, all this nonsense. The USFL has three key witnesses. It's my favorite part in a way. I mean, there's so many favorite parts, but I love this. A drunk Howard Cosell, Al Davis, who's just insane,
right?
And Donald Trump. And the NFL sees Donald Trump as a gift from God.
Oh, my God.
Because he's unsympathetic. He's just an asshole. I mean, he just is. Huh? He's just a jerk. And he's unlike one. I interviewed one of the jurors who remembered vividly him trying to visually intimidate the jurors by staring them down during his testimony.
I don't see any of that. Yeah,
of course, the case
would be a real shame if something bad were to happen. You were
little hand. It does come in handy. Did you cover the trial? Were you guys at the trial?
No, because I was already on to the Rams. Richard Hoffer.
Oh, the great Richard Hoffer.
The great Richard Hoffer, yeah. I could just see that phone call about him having to do this. And then he wrote brilliant. He was, you know, he never wanted to write anything. And then when he wrote it, it was the greatest.
He's my idol.
He's great. He's the best.
Yeah. He would root for things.
I got to SI when he was at SI, and I would read his stuff and be like, I can't touch this. Yeah. It's amazing.
Well, he had the great exit from the LA Times of all time. He wrote the cover story on George Foreman, and it came out, and that's how the Times knew he was leaving.
Oh, that's
no
funny.
No kidding.
He was. Wow. I guess I'm leaving now.
Okay. I'm done. Anyway, the trial happens. Trial happens. Trump is an embarrassment. Yeah. And what the jury basically decides is the USFL is right. Like, the USFL is right. The NFL is monopolizing. Right. The NFL is trying to bully the USFL.
Right.
But it's USFL's fault. And you guys are a bunch of idiots. And there was a report presented to the USFL owners. They paid a league that had almost no money left, paid $600,000 for a private firm, a consulting firm, to give them a breakdown of whether they should move to fall or spring. The woman presents it and says, do not move to fall. It does not make any sense. You have an okay thing going.
Yeah.
And Donald Trump is the first guy in that meeting. This is BS, blah, 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 blah. The jury says, all right, you guys are right. However, you're your own worst enemy. Here's a dollar. And the best moment of that trial is John Mara, owner of the New York Giants, sitting literally next to Donald Trump in the courtroom, opening his thing, taking out his wallet, taking out a dollar. It was basically
trebled this.
Trebled
to three.
Yeah, trebled to three.
Trebled.
But did the jury get it right, or did they understand the law? Did they just screw it up?
No.
Could they have ruled for a huge judgment, or did they?
Yeah, they could have, but I think they were right.
But did they know what they were doing?
Yeah, they did. All right. Okay. So there was a lot of. I talked to a juror, and I talked to a lot of people from the case. And there was always afterwards, there was a lot of the jury screwed it up. And Harvey Meyerson, the lawyer for the NFL, was like, they screwed it up. They didn't know what they were doing. That actually wasn't true. And then I had this long talk with the juror, one of the key jurors on the case. And she said, no, we understood what we were doing. We understood the entirety of it. We just couldn't reward them money for being their own.
Yeah.
Is it possible that if you had had Bassett, who everyone seems to agree was a wonderful man, mm-hmm. maybe some other sympathetic people,
mm-hmm.
that effect on the jury could have maybe shifted things a bit?
They had people ready to call who they never called. They just did not call people. Donald Trump decided this is my show. And here's the other thing.
I'm worried for
him. Wait, here's something.
Bassett was sort of
the
John McCain of today's story, right? The guy you're looking to, the guy that's this.
So what you're saying, he was a loser.
No, but the same guy, the guy that got it, the guy that would fight Trump, who wrote the great letter, I'd punch you in the face. John Bassett is dying of brain cancer. So, I mean,
the parallels.
The parallels.
Insane.
The cautionary tale that this book really is.
I know, it's scary.
And the foreshadowing, and if people had just, if you'd written this book
five years ago. Why didn't you get this out earlier?
You know what frustrates me, I will say?
But
I keep saying, I keep telling my publicist, who's great, but I'm always like, we could get this on news shows and we could talk about this because Past is so prologue. And it hasn't, the Woodward book came out the same day as mine, which wasn't helpful.
Right.
But you said it. John Bassett is John McCain. The guy gets sick.
Yeah.
He's the one foil of Trump.
Crazy.
And he walks all over him. And then the other one, 100%, the Flutie contract is insane. Talk about, this is the craziest crap ever. He signs Doug Flutie. the heading into the 85 season. Right. It's a stupid contract. First of all, they have Brian Sipe as their quarterback.
Yeah. Yeah.
Second of all, Flutie, in the NFL, Flutie's a fourth or fifth round pick. Like, he's a 5'9" quarterback.
Barely a quarterback.
Right. Right. Maybe they switch, but where are you going to switch a 5'9"?
I don't know where you were, but anyway.
Yes. He had a much better career than anyone thought.
Yeah, right? Well, he's a great Canadian player.
Right,
Yeah.
But they signed him to this deal. He signs him to a 6-year, $8.3 million, 3 years guaranteed. And he sends a letter. First, he tells his partners with the Generals, don't worry, you would do this better than me. So if I'll say it and you can interpret it if you'd like. Don't worry, he says this, don't worry, the other owners are going to, I'm going to sign Doug Flutie, but the other owners in the league are going to pay for it. That was literally, it is the Mexico, I always say, Flutie's a Mexico wall before the Mexico wall. And this is a crazy, he sends a letter that I have. Jerry Argovich wrote a book years ago that nobody read that was excellent. And he has the letter from Donald Trump to the other owners, where he says to the, he writes in a letter, I have done the USFL a great favor by bringing, he's like, you can see the results on the field. It was lie after lie. Attendance had plummeted from 84 to 85 because they were moving
attendance
to the
Attendance is up.
Greatest attended game ever.
Right, but like, here's a perfect example.
We had 17 people in the stands. It was the highest attendance of all time.
You can't see the fingers, but
wait, you can't anyway.
Right, but then he says on the thing, you can see the results already, right? Okay, the Generals and Birmingham Stallions opened in Birmingham back-to-back seasons just because it's the USFL. In 1984, they drew about 60,000 to that game. In 1985, with Doug Flutie starting at quarterback, they drew 30-something thousand. Ooh. And he's like, you can see the results all over. It was just nonsense. And
you
not
can clearly see the results.
And not one owner. Oh, yeah. It literally is the inauguration. It's the Birmingham style.
Perfect.
And the best way to present this, and you've done it, but is to not make it political,
right?
Because it's not political.
It's not political.
It's just it's like he is.
He was a Democrat, probably. Yeah. I tell people, I've seen this story 30 years ago. It has nothing to do with politics,
right?
You know, he is what he is. It doesn't matter what party he belongs to. He doesn't care what he
is. I kept saying to people, I've said this throughout. I say, I was writing this book during the election. You know, I was saying you could not write this book and then think, oh, you know who'd be a good president? This guy.
Right.
I mean, so you couldn't, people are like, oh, you're biased. I'm like, I'm not biased. I'm freaking informed that this guy is a con man. Like, what?
Right, but when he was a Democrat, he was still, I would say,
I would
he was
not
an
have
idiot.
Voted for him either.
It didn't matter what he was.
Right.
It's like you can say
who he is.
It's who he is, not what he is.
We mentioned Rick Riley earlier. He has a book coming out, I think, in the spring called Commander in Chief, which is all about how Donald Trump plays golf.
Oh,
if you're this person, you're this
person
all the time.
He looks like he would kick back into the fairway, to be honest.
He's admitted he did, and Riley wrote a piece about him. Where
but
like,
it's so easy to, you know, it's so tribal now, and it's all left or right or whatever, but this is not.
It's facts.
I don't know anyone's political affiliation.
Yeah.
It has nothing to do with his political affiliation. It's just that he was 30 years ago.
I'm agnostic, by the way.
He was just a con man. He was just a con man when it came to this stuff.
Speaking of the end of the league, you guys covered the last Express game, which is an epic.
Oh, it's just
I remember both of you telling
itself.
Me things. Can you just kind of go over what that game was like?
I must have blocked this out of my memory but you say that there was a field goal contest for the sports.
Your article is invaluable, by the way. The one that's online.
I wrote a thing about
field
the 25th anniversary.
I sort of remember it now.
I remember because you remember that guy who was working for like City News Service? Stephen Herbert. Would always see me in the press box and go, let's do a field goal kicking contest. And so he kept reminding me of it. So the thing about the PR is I had to tell my boss when I was going to the game, I didn't know where the San Fernando Valley was. My whole life is South Bay, and they go, we're playing this thing at Pierce College. I go, I don't even know how to get there.
So did you know it existed?
I heard about it because there was like the song Valley Girl was big then. So I had to get Herb Vincent, who by now was the PR person for the Express. I said, Herb, can I just drive with you? Just take me to the game. Otherwise, I might not get there. So Herb and I get to the game, and there's nobody there. And then as I wrote, and you used it, it looked like a movie studio set. It was just this odd-looking thing. And they brought us down from the press box of a field goal kicking contest. I don't know why or what happened. It didn't matter. It was just this bizarre.
Isn't there something
promotion.
About a bus driver refusing to drive?
Okay, so the team. You know, did Steve ever talk to you about the bus driver story?
Yeah, about them taking a collection.
Yeah, Steve had to take a collection because the bus driver would refuse to take them over the hill into the valley because he wasn't getting paid.
If I don't get my $500, I am not driving this bus.
Yeah, under the roof. And Herb Vincent, who is now
SEC,
the head communication down at LSU. now he's at
SEC. SEC. Oh, okay.
But he tweeted me something a couple weeks ago about that I didn't know this. Maybe it was in your book, maybe it wasn't. But he said he carried a telecopier in his car in case the Express folded because he thought it could fold at any minute.
Right.
And he had some. I don't know, people probably didn't know what that is, but I got. Yeah, like something he could.
It's what we had used to write our stories on and send them out right away over the telephone lines.
He said
it was like a fax machine.
He had it in his car in case the Express folded.
He probably had it in the car.
So you would have to pull over somewhere, attach it to it.
You could attach it to a phone and release the.
It had to be a phone plug, though.
How many people were at that last game?
They didn't have turnstiles. That I actually know.
They had to set. I remember they had to set up chairs, empty chairs that they knew nobody would sit in because there was a league minimum attendance requirement. Might have been 15,000.
This was on a Saturday afternoon, right?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
And
in the middle,
thought of two future Super Bowl MVPs who played in that game.
Right, Doug Williams
and Steve Young.
Wow.
Steve Young. And I sat in the press box next to this guy who I didn't know, and it turned out that it was, why am I blanking? The Buffalo Bills coach.
Marv Levy.
Marv Levy is watching the game next to me. You know, he's going to be in four Super Bowls with the Bills later with Jim Kelly. And I was like making small talk. Well, he was scouting. He was scouting. I think he was working for Chicago then or something.
The Blitz were dead at that point.
Okay. So he had no job. He was looking for a job. Marv Levy's sitting there just looking for a job. Future
like,
Hall
how did my
coach.
Life come to this?
It's like, where is, I don't, this is just like a whole bizarro.
Did everyone have a feeling that this was it?
Oh, yeah.
Well, it looked like the end. You couldn't go much lower than this. Because it was just such a bizarre thing to see.
Right.
And then I just, as the game ends, I think I just remember like they walking to the cars in the parking lot. It was just like this.
With their parents.
Yeah. It felt like you just watched a kid's soccer game.
Well, you know, Doug Williams and Steve Young shake hands and Williams goes to Young, what the hell are we doing here? This is a mess, you know.
What?
Were you at that game?
I had just graduated from college and I came back to volunteer that game.
Weren't you working the scoreboard?
Because
no, I mean serious. Weren't you working the scoreboard?
No, because it was a day game and the scoreboard was immediately behind the goalpost and the sun, you couldn't see how much time was on the clock. So I had to sit underneath the scoreboard with a walkie-talkie and say, you know, there's 8:34 on the scoreboard so that they could type the play-by-play.
Oh, my Lord.
And it wasn't televised.
And then I had to do post-game quotes for the Outlaws, and Doug Williams said to me, he goes, this is arguably the lowest point of my life.
But these were the Arizona Outlaws.
Arizona Outlaws.
Formerly, two years later, he's Super Bowl MVP.
Yeah. Wait, I just want to say one thing. Not only is he Super Bowl MVP, he threw four touchdown passes in that game. Of the four, one was a Kelvin Bryant, Philadelphia Stars.
Oh, great.
One was a Gary Clark, Jacksonville Bulls. One was a Ricky Sanders, Houston Gamblers.
Yeah. Wow.
Which is crazy.
That's amazing. Okay, so the league had all this talent. They had guys with money. Is there anything they could have done to make that sucker work?
Stay in the spring.
Yeah.
Okay.
And still, and I think you even mentioned this in your, it still probably would not have been a long time.
But don't you think 87 comes with the NFL strike?
That's where you, I think that was a great point. The 87 strike was filled with USFL players.
And I just think there's if 87, if the USFL stays into spring, if the 87 stays until the spring, I mean, if the USFL stays until 87 in the spring, all of a sudden you have this year of crazy football anarchy.
Right.
And you could see a lot of guys jumping to the USFL. I also think you could see a panicked NFL being like, we need to nip this in the bud. Jacksonville will take you.
Right.
Memphis will take you. Oakland, we can take you. Baltimore and maybe Birmingham. Like those five. Birmingham's a weird wild card in that one.
Yeah.
And if you remember what Klosterman had done with money that nobody really had, was build, and you remember Klosterman had been fired from the Rams, a very proud man. He lived in Cole Porter's house on La Cienega Boulevard.
Dressed impeccably all the time.
Oh, perfect.
Wasn't he the Duke of Dining Out?
Yeah. Great star quarterback at LMU, Loyola Marymount, and very proud. And he was fired by the Rams in the great Georgia frontier. Yeah. And it was all revenge for him. He was competing against. He wanted to build an NFL franchise that could compete with the Rams.
And
they
did.
Made a mistake, and he did.
Yeah, and it was full of
two Hall of Famers.
Yeah,
Gary Zimmerman.
How about that offensive line? Yeah. I mean, Derek Kennard, Jeff Hart,
Mark Addix,
Gary Zimmerman, Mark Addix. Right?
Yes.
Yeah.
Some
Pro Bowlers. Tony Zendejas.
So JoJo Townsend, Kevin Nutt. Like, it was a great.
So that team, had it been allowed to mature in the spring, and he said the NFL strike comes along in 87, LA would have been in a position where, you know, they may be desirable, you know?
Yeah.
So, it was a shame of it, but who knows how long it would have lasted, but certainly going to the fall was an insane idea and doomed from the start.
It was like what you pointed out in the book too, a USFL had happened already once earlier with the same name as a result of the AFL challenging the NFL.
Right.
And then it was basically an owner who wanted to get his own team and basically got it.
Yeah.
And so it's always there for the taking if there's an ownership group that wants to get, get his foot in. It's like, let's just start this, challenge league.
The USFL, the AFL merged with the NFL, the ABA merged with the NBA. We haven't seen something like that happen in a long time. I'm sure the USFL would have liked that. Is that, do you think that'll ever happen again in any sport where you'll get this renegade league that comes along and manages to basically force itself in? Or are the leagues now so big?
Yeah, there
are
already
rich?
So many teams. Back then there weren't that many teams.
Right.
Yeah.
It was always a numbers thing.
It's also funny, don't you think, how people are like, oh, the NFL's in trouble. Like, the NFL is in such better shape now than it was in the 80s. Like, the NFL now is Apple and IBM combined. I mean, it's just this enormous monolith.
Yeah, you should be breaking it up rather than building it up.
Yeah, they're billionaire owners now instead of, they were millionaires, now they're billionaires.
Yeah.
So, but it's, what I like about the Express and the USFL is it's a fraternity, it's a shared experience. And, a lot of these guys would end up in broadcasting or they go on the NFL. And if you say you covered the NFL, you could have an instant a conversation with somebody.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Rick Neuheisel today, I saw him at Pac-12 Media Day, and he was jealous because I got an advanced copy of the book.
Oh,
and all he wanted to talk about was Clinton Mangus. The
best team in the history of football.
Yeah, we haven't even talked about the gunslingers, but you can have a conversation. It's a conversation starter. It's a fraternity. Ricky Ellis, who was a tight end for the Express and Cal State Fullerton back when they played football, he lives in Diamond Bar neighborhood. So I see him occasionally. Oh, he wants to talk Express. Tom Ramsey.
Yeah.
I don't know how many people you interviewed for the book.
About 400.
Okay. What was the most general reaction? Was it kind of like, oh, nice nostalgia? Was some of it like opportunity missed? Was some of it like I got screwed?
Very, very little, if any of that, I got screwed.
Yeah.
Even though some of these guys did financially.
Yeah.
I think there were two things. I think number one, it's almost like I lazily compare it sometimes to a fraternity party remembering, but I actually don't think it's that. I think it's like a really terrifying flight to Hawaii where like, you know what I mean? Like you don't remember, you remember how insane it was, like the bus and like the John Hadel getting punched by a player, stuff like that.
Yeah.
And yet you did end up getting to Hawaii, and like Hawaii was great. So you also remember all the awesome stuff about it. And I also think there was one guy I interviewed who played for the Portland Breakers, and he told me that for 30 years, every day, he has the team photo above his, like wherever he does his work. Because he looks at it every day, and he always thinks, at least for a moment, just how sad it makes him. And not to make this a Trump bash, but I will say, when the 30 for 30 came out with Mike Tolan, and Trump called it small potatoes, I actually think that wounded a lot of guys. It definitely wounded me. I was like, it's fine if you chalk it up to a failure, but how many jobs did that give people?
Yeah.
And how much excitement did that bring to people's lives? So I get, you could be like, it didn't work out. But to just be like, it was small potatoes.
Right.
Maybe it was to you, wasn't to them.
Right, or my future wife who was laid off, all these mom and pops, the LA Express left town with owing people, not big people, little people, $1 million, vendors. People that did the program.
Cheerleaders.
People clean the cheerleading uniforms. Yeah.
I had to go cover a small claims court of a cheerleader who was suing the team.
That's awesome.
It's like, what am I doing in this? I don't even know how to cover a court case.
And it really hurt. And I talked to Don Klosterman, and it really broke him up. I mean, it really hurt him that this happened.
Yeah.
He got duped and he was fooled.
Right.
And he got pulled into this because he's, nobody wants to see little people hurt. And that, so it, There is a sad aspect to it because it could have been something, not something huge, but it could have been something sustainable.
I was going to say the greatest revenge of the abused USFL guy story ever is the San Antonio Gunslingers, who were just the most dysfunctional outfit ever in any sporting league of all time. They had a defensive backs coach named Bill Bradley who played for the Eagles, and he stopped getting paid. And Clint Mangus, the owner, who just like Oldenburg was crazy, he owed him about, I don't know what it was, $70,000. So they played in the Alamo Stadium. Were you guys ever there? It was a high school stadium converted into a, you know, an ancient and crappy. Yeah. And they used to have to bring in chairs. They had to bring in 6,000 chairs to meet the minimum attendance. Last game in San Antonio Gunslinger history, Bill Bradley rents a bunch of trucks, pays off the security guard at the stadium, backs the trucks in, loads the chairs onto the trucks, brings them, makes multiple trips, brings them to Fort Worth, sells them for, I think, $8 a pop, and never tells anyone until we talk. God. And that is how he made his money.
Wow. Well, these, I'm getting that money one way or another.
Yeah, right. I'm getting that money. It might come from chairs. But
these are the stories. The LA Express, the carpenter that walks into Mona Williams.
Oh, I will kill you.
I will kill you unless you, you know. And that was the funny part. You go down there and when it was all ending, and the league had taken over operations. You talk about it was the opposite of Trump. The league did pay for the Express.
Yeah. Oh, wow. Yeah.
They had million-dollar guaranteed contracts to all these guys that they'd signed.
Yeah, they had to pay them all.
And so you would go to the Express headquarters, and the lights were out. The grass, nobody had mowed the lawn.
They stopped serving steak and salad at the for the players.
But the parking lot is full of Mercedes.
So funny.
You know, and they hire our one of character we can't even get into, Nelson Mercado, one of the great characters, security guards who was brought into after the Greg Fields. But Nelson, who I have lost touch with him now, but he just
left me a message.
Oh, my God.
That guy's the nicest human being on the planet.
Tell him I said hello, because I, you know, he was the greatest guy, but he had the job of protecting it's coach, a crazy, right?
Well, I mean,
you have to tell where Nelson came from before.
Well, you mean who he worked for?
Yeah,
can I tell the Greg Fields story real quick? Because it's the best story of all time.
Sure.
It is the best story in the history of football. And it's not mine. I don't own it. I just, you know. Greg Fields. Now, do you guys remember Greg Fields playing for LA? Like, did he register at all? Because he wasn't great.
I remember the name.
Yeah.
I remember the name, but
yeah, he was not, certainly wasn't a standout.
He had 12 sacks, but it was 18 games, so he had the equivalent of like 7.5. Yeah. But 1983, plays for the Express. Now, he played for the Colts as a rookie, got cut, out of Grambling, free agent. And Barry Krause was the Colts' first round pick that year out of Alabama. And when Barry Krause would walk by in the locker room, Greg Fields would go like, hey, big paper boy, there's a big paper boy, because he's making big money. Barry Krause, in turn, would be like, you're the big paper boy. So Greg Fields became known as Big Paper. And I was with Tom Ramsey, the former Express quarterback, working on this book. He's like, you got to find out about Big Paper. Big Paper's your guy. So Big Paper had been, a year after the Colts, he was in camp with the Falcons, and he's cut, and he refuses to leave. He's just like, I know you cut me, but I'm not leaving. So they have to bring an armed security guard to get Greg Fields to leave. That's the end of his NFL anything. But of course, the USFL would take anybody. The LA Express signed Fields. 83 is a good player. 84, he's in camp. John Hadle is now the coach instead of you can't Emil. And John Hadle is like, yeah, we're going to cut Greg. And his assistants were like, eh. It's like, nah, it's okay. So he calls Greg Fields. And Greg Fields' best friend on the Express was Al Burleson, Nate Burleson's father. And he had been cut the day before. And Greg Fields was like, he's like, if they cut me today, there's going to be war around here. It's like, okay. So he called, but John Hadle doesn't know this. So Greg Fields comes in the office and he's like, John's like, John Hadle's a nice guy. He's like, listen, Greg, you've contributed a lot to this team, but, and Greg Fields just goes, pop, and punches him in the face. You motherfucker. He's like being dragged out of the office. Then he starts calling in death threats to the team, right? I'm going to kill the coach, blah, 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 Greg. And he's showing up at practices, standing at the fence like this, just staring. So they hire Nelson Mercado, one of the nicest human beings ever, who at the time is working as Liberace's bodyguard in Las Vegas. But he's from L.A. And they're like, we have this nut job lineman. Will you come? Oh, yeah, I'll come now. Okay. He asks Liberace for a leave of absence. He takes a literal leave of absence from Liberace. Oh. Comes to L.A.
Don't we all?
He puts a tracker on Greg Fields' car. Greg Fields, he said, Nelson told me, had a gun in the back of his car. He was calling in death threats to the team.
Okay.
And Nelson's kind of like, I can't believe this is my lot in life. Like, this is what I'm going to do. And this is only in the USFL. There's nowhere else in the world this happens. Everyone knows about Greg Fields, but the Gunslingers need defensive line help. So perfect they name. Signed Greg Fields. I swear to God, I've said this. This is the equivalent of, I'm working at Sears. I threatened to kill my boss, and Macy's is like, I don't know. He has... you know, so.
Did you see how the paint department?
He got that thing humming.
Yeah. It was good.
So he signed.
Painter, I'll kill you.
That'll be $23. They Gunslinger signed him.
Craftsman's bitch.
I didn't know you're allowed to curse it.
Oh, absolutely. It's the internet.
He's the only one who does, but whatever. Okay.
They signed Greg Fields. He comes to San Antonio. He's greeted by the coaching staff, all wearing helmets and pads. Right? And they have an article about him punching the coach. And he actually says, and I will say, his quote is, "Oh man, that's cold. You got my shit in the wall." But he thought it was funny. This is the amazing part, though, because this is one of those stories that just San Antonio signs him, but the owner, Clint Mangus, who's just ran out of money, stops paying players. Greg Fields is getting pissed off. In fact, the GM of the team was a 71-year-old Korean war vet. And when players would knock on his door to get paid, their offices were two trailers in the parking lot of Alamo Stadium. He would climb out the window and get in his car and drive off. Anyway, Greg Fields follows Clint Mangus home one day. And he has a baseball bat with him. And Mangus gets out of the car and he sees Greg Fields. And Greg Fields is 6'6", 280. You know, Mangus is a little guy. He's got the bat. And he's like, "Listen." And he lives in a mansion. He goes, "I see where you live. I know you got money. I think you want to pay me." Clint Mangus goes, "Wait here." 10 minutes later, comes back out with $17,000 in cash and gives it to him. He's like, "Are we good?" Greg Fields is like, "Yeah, we're good." And drives off. And nobody, Greg Fields, I could not find. And I had two addresses for him.
You,
and I
took, yeah, you read over a whole chapter about
it. Oh, yeah, it was really a thrill. Really I took good, my son on a road trip to San Francisco. The worst dad in America.
No, right.
Of course you are.
And me, my 9-year-old son Emmett, and Greg Fields, a food court in Sacramento, California, eating Cold Stone Creamery, and him telling me about his time. And
didn't he send your son out to go get him an ice cream?
He goes, I was like, "Greg, do you want something?" And he's like, to my son, he's like, "Go get me one of those cherry vanillas." And my son's like, "Okay."
Was he holding a bat at the time?
He was not. He was actually a nice guy.
And your son now has a Greg Fields jersey.
There's this business that makes USFL jerseys, and my son has three. He has a Greg Fields, LA Express. He has an Ed Luther Jacksonville Bulls, because Ed Luther, turns out, lives about a mile and a half away from me in Southern California. And he has a Doug Williams Oklahoma Valley jersey.
Ooh, that's nice.
This is the best episode we've ever done.
How many? What time are we in?
Oh,
how
God.
How long
be,
are we done?
How long is it supposed to be?
It's at 55 minutes.
There you go. Man. So we an hour on the USFL, and we could do another hour. Jeff, you're going to be signing books tonight, right?
I am.
Where are you going to be at?
What's the name of the place?
Chevalier?
How do you pronounce it?
Chevalier.
It's the oldest bookstore in Los Angeles.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
And then where do you go from here? Where are you going to be?
Probably home to eat.
But you bet.
I was in New York promoting. I've done a lot of TV and a lot of. And I'm not just saying this. This is by far the most fun because I love. No, I'm not kidding. I just want to say because a lot of it is like. So what did you like about the USFL? Or so and people always
how
confused,
did Donald Trump screw right. this?
What was Donald Trump's role? And the big one is like they'll ask me about a World Football League team instead of a USFL team.
Oh, you know,
like stuff like that. So this is like to me, this is like hog heaven. This really is.
Awesome.
Not asking
for
about
you.
And
NFL
when you say hug, you looked right at John. But anyways, so thanks for coming by. Come back anytime.
The Express, first of all, the Express, we're not going to be called the Express, right? They were going to be called the Olympics.
The Satellites or the Olympics.
The Satellites. Or the, and the satellites. I love that he says in the book, they're going to Satellites, but they agreed that sucked.
Yeah, that's terrible.
That so we'd
terrible.
Be talking about satellite football at this point, maybe.
Oh, yes.
Interesting.
Ooh. Do come back sometime. We'll talk some college football, basketball, all that junk.
Sure.
Awesome. Thank you for tuning in. I hope you enjoyed this. I know you had to. And go buy the book. He's a nice guy. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
Bye.
Steve Young said, "Wait,